So then they started the groundwater treatment systems, and y'all have heard some of that. Some of you may have gone on the field visit that Mobile Gas had recently. So the first thing is the treatment system over the leaks in the springs. They have three springs they've identified in the Beaver Pond, and they are all gassing mercaptan into the air that you are all breathing and having the health impacts. So they said, well, we're going to cover it up and we're going to treat it, and then it's going to all be okay. So in October of 12, the first system was put there, and it captured and treated the mercaptans in the air. And the system consisted of air stripping and carbon filter. And then in September 13, almost a year later, they went with ozone treatment. And then August of 14, they got a better ozone treatment. So if you go out there, you see it somewhat covered over, where it's pulling the gas out of the groundwater and treating it with ozone, and it's discharging it into the surface water. But when it discharges it into the surface water, it still has mercaptan left at a little bitty level, but it still has mercaptan left. And then the second treatment was where, if you went on the tour, that's where they took you. It's 24 recovery wells. So here you see all the 24 recovery wells, all in a line, sort of like little mushrooms. And what happens is they pump the groundwater to the surface, they put it in a tank, they treat it with ozone to destroy the mercaptan. They put it in another tank, which is a holding tank, so it can stay in contact with the ozone for enough time. And it discharges into the surface water. And guess what? Not all the mercaptan is treated. So it's still some residual mercaptan in the water that's going into the surface water and flowing through your neighborhoods. So then what happens? There's a need for air monitoring of mercaptan. So the field office of ADEM here in Mobile performs what's called mercaptan odor patrol in the 8 Mile area. And it's once a week. And in the last year, from June 23rd of 2015 to June 20th of 2016, they've had 51 mercaptan odor events. Now, I tell you that June 20th of this year is the last data in the file. So today I call the agency, and they were out in the field, but late this afternoon they called me back and said that I was scared they were stopping the odor patrol. But she said, no, it's continuing, and we've done it every week. But I fill out the forms, and then I send it in, and it goes like to the central office data something or other, and it takes them about a month to put it on the file so you can see it. So remember, we talked about 51 monitoring events. A total of 32 of those events, or 63%, detected odors ranging from OL1, odor level 1, odors barely detectable, odor level 2, distant and defined, any unpleasant characteristics recognized, and odor level 3, strong enough to cause attempts at avoidance. Okay, O1 is barely, O2, yes, and O3, really bad. So 19 of the mercaptan odor patrol events had none detect for any odor. And what happened? Most of those events were when the wind was 5 to 10 miles an hour. So when the wind is strong, it disperses it and you don't smell it. But when the wind is low or calm is when you smell it. So let's look at O3. We've had one event of O3 strong enough to cause attempts to avoid. It occurred in that last year of data that I looked at, and the reading was detected at Parker Residence on January the 15th of this year at 8:22 p.m. So at 8:22 on a winter month, it's dark. So you didn't have the sunlight to break in. And the wind was calm, so it wasn't getting dispersed. So this is what the person that was performing the patrol stated. The odor at Parker Residence is one of the strongest I have ever observed since performing the patrol. It was strong enough that I did not complete my notes at the site. I left to avoid the odors. Now, was that bad for the person performing it to write those notes down in the record? She may or may not have notified the company, but the company doesn't immediately then go out with their sniffers and figure out where is it coming from. And that's the piece we don't have. When you have a big odor event and ADM documents it, right away, the company should be out there finding out where it's happening. So let's also talk about what else occurred during that event. If we look at odor level 2, distant and defined, any unpleasant characteristics recognizable? Same day, January 15, the park residents had an odor level of O level 3, and three locations had odor level 2. That same sampling event, Perpetual Grace Cemetery, entering the cemetery, the concrete bridge in the cemetery, and Ida Lloyd Drive had O2. And oh, by the way, these are the ones that had 1 on that same event. They were the intersection of Shelton Beach Road, Superior Drive. Now, that was an event they should have gone out and figured, where are the leaks coming from? ADM says we know the extent of contamination of groundwater, but ADM and the company are not working together to address the odor problems and help figure out where the leaks are. So besides the three locations of odor level 2 in the January 15th event, we had the Perpetual Grace Cemetery location within the cemetery and the cemetery concrete bridge on March 4th of 16. The wind at that time was north at less than 2. On March 14th, so March 4th, March 14th, Perpetual Grace Cemetery bridge, and at 9:30 at night, so again, it's enough time without sunlight. The Perpetual Grace Cemetery concrete bridge, odor level 2, January 15th, so just over and over and over again, we were picking up odor levels too. And during the mercaptan odor en route to the park residents, they picked up O2 in April. They also picked it up in November. And the wind was west and south. And May 17th, mercaptan odors of 2. So over and over again, we're getting 2. Now, this is the catch. All the mercaptan odors of level 3 and level 2 occurred after the week of November 16th of 2015. And why is that important? Because that's when they turned on those 24 recovery wells. Before that, we only had O1, a little there. And when they turned on those recovery wells, suddenly you started getting O2 and O3. So something happened. They're drawing down the aquifer. Is that causing something? Is it causing the groundwater to move differently? Is it shoving more up in the beaver pond and the springs? Is it leaking around the wells? Or is it leaking in some of the equipment? They have 2 big tanks out there. So what I'm here to tell you tonight is you're worse now than you were in 2015. Your odors are worse now. And that's why it was easy for her to do the health impacts and record those health impacts over, what, the last month that you've been working on it. If you'd have done it in 15, you probably wouldn't have had that many. You would have had them, but it was at minimal level. But in 2016, the odors are much, much worse, and the associated health impacts are much, much worse. And I'll be the target tomorrow when Mobile Gas says, she doesn't know what she's talking about. But obviously, they haven't looked at the overall data, nor has ADEM. ADEM's going out there every week, and they're doing their job. They're going out one night a week and doing their job. But nobody's looking at what the data shows. And y'all are the guinea pigs that are able to fill out those forms. Survey that y'all have done over the last couple of weeks documents the same health impacts from two previous health surveys and from all the information the community has provided. The community of 8 Mile and the surrounding areas should not continue to be exposed to mercaptan odor events, mercaptan chemicals in the air, and associated health impacts. There is a need for additional remediation to appropriately address the mercaptan situation. Thank you.